Hello, my name is Pastor Ben, and I am the pastor of Gibraltar Bible Baptist Church in Gibraltar, Michigan. I want to thank you so much for taking the time again today to join us for our online Bible study as we study the Word of God together. In our study today, we'll be looking at the Gospel of John in chapter 20. And so let me invite you to take your Bible and turn with me, please, to the Gospel of John and chapter 20. You can see that I'm doing something a little different today. We are, I believe, coming to the end of quarantine. And here for the last few days, my wife has been visiting her parents with our daughter, Caitlin. So she's been gone with our daughter, and I've been spending a little man time with my two sons, Matthew, who's 11 years old, and Christian, who is 2 years old. And it seems like if there's about four or five Christians in my life right now, he keeps me very, very busy. And so because I've been watching them, I've been working from home this week. And so I'll be preaching from my living room, which you see here on the screen. I'm in my living room, and I made sure to turn off the fireplace. Otherwise, it might get a little hot for the preacher and the audience as I preach the Word of God today. But anyhow, I'm so delighted to be with you and open up the Word of God together with you today as we study the Word of God. John chapter 20 in your Bibles, and the title of our study today is this: From Pride to Faith. From Pride to Faith. Now, in our last Bible study together, and if you've been following our Bible study videos here at Gibraltar Bible Baptist Church, you know that we've been going through John chapter 19, the crucifixion narrative, and now we've been studying verse by verse through John chapter 20. And Lord willing, we're going to continue on to the end of John chapter 21. We'll have to see how that goes. But in our last Bible study together, we saw how the disciples began their metamorphosis from fear to faith. We saw that here in verses 19 through 23. But John chapter 20 has a larger underlying theme throughout the entire chapter of seeing and believing, which we have been considering. This theme of seeing and believing is revealed in verses 1, 5, 6, 8, 11, 12, 14, 18, 20, 25, and 29, the clinching verse, which we will look at today. Seeing and believing is the theme of John chapter 20. So now we come to the end of the chapter, the penultimate text of faith and doubting, where the pride of one disciple in particular is exposed. You know his name. We call him Doubting Thomas. So we'd like to consider the faith and failure of Doubting Thomas today, or what I'm titling this Bible study, From Pride to Faith. Let me give you our big idea as we study the Word of God together today. Our big idea is this: blessed are they who believe without seeing. As Jesus himself says in our text, blessed are they who believe without seeing. Now let's look at what the Word of God has to teach us today. There are 3 points to our Bible study together today. I'll give them to you as we study the Word of God. I encourage you to get a notebook and a pen and write some of these thoughts down, as God will challenge your heart and you'll remember them later. Number one, we see in verses 24 and 25, the pride of unbelief. The pride of unbelief. The Bible says in verses 24 and 25, now Thomas, called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said to him, we have seen the Lord. So he said to them, unless I see his hands, the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and put my hands into his side, I will not believe. Now let me back up just a minute before we get into the text. John chapter 20 lays out the progression of faith in the resurrection. There's a process to faith. Faith doesn't just happen in the snap of a fingers. There is, by God's own design, by merit of the human nature, there's a process for the seed of faith to be planted in the heart of an individual before it produces its full flower and bloom. So John chapter 20 describes that process for us. As we looked into the chapter, we see the process of visual witness. We're talking about particularly faith in the resurrection now. Visual witness to the resurrection, verbal testimony of the resurrection, disbelief in the resurrection, and finally, belief in the resurrection. We've already considered the visual witness of Mary Magdalene, followed by Peter and John. For whatever reason, the Apostle John does not talk about the verbal testimony of Peter and John after they went to the empty tomb. John doesn't speak to his own verbal testimony or Peter's verbal testimony, but John does tell us that Mary Magdalene had passed along the message of the resurrection to the rest of the disciples, yet they had not believed. We see this in verses 18 and 19. In verse 18, Mary Magdalene meets with the disciples, tells them that the Lord is alive. But in verse 19 and following, they're in the upper room, still not believing in the resurrection, even though Mary Magdalene had told them. Now, in our last Bible study together, verses 19 through 23, we see that the disciples changed their minds when Jesus himself appeared in the midst of them and commissioned them. This was the beginning of their transition from fear to faith. So now in verse 24, we have already studied the appearance of Jesus in the upper room the same night as the resurrection. That was the same day as the resurrection. The disciples are fearful in the upper room. Jesus appeared in the midst of them. He breathed on them, peace to you. He gave them the Holy Spirit, or as we discussed, he prophesied of the future coming of the Holy Spirit, and he commissioned them. But that night, the night of Easter Sunday, the very first Easter Sunday, while the disciples were gathered in the upper room, there was one disciple that was missing. And of course, we know that the missing disciple, at least one, that missing disciple was Thomas. Now, let me just pause here briefly. By telling us that Thomas was missing from the gathering of disciples on the Easter evening, John is not trying to say anything here about the dangers of missing church. That is not John's point. So I'm not going to abuse the word of God and preach on a topic that John himself is not teaching or preaching on. Rather, John's point is simply that the first night that the resurrected Jesus showed himself to the disciples, Thomas, for whatever reason, was absent. Now, in verse 24, if we were preaching through the entire book of John, as is our usual fashion, we would have already met Thomas and gotten to know him a little bit earlier in the book. There are a few other mentions of the Apostle Thomas in the Gospel of John. We meet Thomas in John 11, verse 16, and in John 14, verse 5. And then here again in John chapter 20, and there's one final mention of Thomas in the Gospel of John in chapter 21, verse 2. Now, three of the four times that Thomas is mentioned in the Gospel of John, Thomas is identified as the twin. That's the Greek word didymus, which sometimes in certain translations is transliterated into the English as didymus. But the literal translation into the English means twin. So that means that Thomas had a twin, whether a brother or a sister. We don't know anything more about that. But that title of the twin or Didymus just helps us to know for sure which Thomas we're talking about. We're talking about the disciple who would become the apostle, one of the 12, and his name was Thomas, and he had a twin sibling. So everybody knows, oh, it's that specific Thomas. So the Bible tells us in verse 24, Thomas called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples, verse 25, therefore said to him, we have seen the Lord. So in this final story in John chapter 20, we see once again, it's unmistakable pattern. At the beginning of John chapter 20, Mary Magdalene did not believe the resurrection until she saw Jesus with her own eyes. Just to briefly review with you, going back to the beginning of John chapter 20, why was Mary Magdalene at the tomb on Easter Sunday morning to begin with? Well, she was at the tomb because she was expecting to find the corpse of a dead Savior. She had not yet believed or understood that Jesus was resurrected. And even though a little later, Peter and John went racing past Mary Magdalene and they went into the tomb and they saw that Jesus was gone and that his grave clothes were lying there, And then they raced out once again with some understanding that Jesus was alive. Mary Magdalene still didn't believe that Jesus had resurrected. She didn't believe it until she turned around outside that tomb early Sunday morning, and she saw a man she thought was the gardener. And that man she thought was the gardener said, "Mary." And in that moment, she recognized, oh, this is the Jesus that I came seeking. I thought he was dead, and now I understand that she's alive. So this scenario of seeing evidence for the resurrection, but yet not believing it until you actually meet the living Savior, that's playing out multiple times in John chapter 20. Evidence for the resurrection, testimony to the resurrection, yet there's no belief in the resurrection until I personally see it with my own eyes. And that's exactly what we have with this account with Thomas here in verse 25. All of the other disciples now, first Mary Magdalene, then Peter and John, now all the disciples, they're all telling Thomas, Jesus is alive. But what's Thomas's response? Thomas says, in order for me to believe that Jesus is alive, I must see him with my own eyes, see the nail prints in his hands, put my hand in his side. I must see and feel with my own senses. Now, please understand here at the end of verse 25, Thomas said to them, unless I see in his hands the print of the nails and put my finger into the print of the nails and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Not only is Thomas stating his unbelief, but there is a clear contrast of attitudes here between the testimony of the disciples and the response of Thomas. On the one hand, over here you have all the disciples, the way that they're portrayed in the text, verses 24 and 25, they're very humble. They're very clear. They're understated. As a matter of fact, the words of the disciples as they testify to Thomas, the disciples use the exact same Greek phrase and words, both in Greek and English, the translation, as Mary Magdalene had used in verse 18. All they said was, we have seen the Lord. Now, their verbiage about seeing is very important to John's narrative. But they simply say to Thomas, they're not trying to hyper-dramatize the situation. They're not being emotional. All they say is, we have seen the Lord. That's the way their testimony is portrayed. But on the other hand, Thomas has a very different flavor and attitude in his response to the disciples' witness. We might even say that Thomas responds in a far more pompous and arrogant fashion. He is absolutely emphatic. He says, I must see with my own eyes, but not only this, I must touch the nail prints in his hands and side. And he says, until I see and touch my own senses, observe this for myself. He says, there is no way I'm going to believe. The way that his negative statement is framed in the Greek, his statement that I will not believe unless I see the nail prints and feel the holes in his side, the unless there is a Greek third class conditional negative. In other words, this is a certain type of conditional sentence that Thomas is using that implies that maybe this could happen. Maybe Christ will show himself to me, Thomas is saying, the same way that Christ showed himself to Mary, Magdalene, and the other disciples. Thomas says that could happen, but it's not very likely, like maybe a 1% chance that this could happen. In fact, as we dig into Thomas's statement a little bit more, we understand that Thomas views the faith of the disciples as foolish and unwarranted. Thomas is really saying to them, clearly, you disciples have got your facts wrong. Clearly, Jesus has died. Clearly, we all know this because he was crucified and buried. Clearly, Thomas is saying, we are without hope. And all of you disciples, Thomas says, are crazy, delusional, and stupid for believing that Jesus is alive again. That's the flavor of the statement of Thomas here in verse 25. And to cap it off, His concluding statement at the end of verse 25 is doubly emphatic. We know this when we look behind the English text into the Greek text. Thomas says in the English, "I will not believe." But in the Greek, he says, "Ume." That's the most powerful way you can say no in the Greek. It's like saying, "No, no." Or to put it into English, "Absolutely not." Thomas says, "Unless all of these things take place and I see Christ for myself, there is no way on earth that I'm going to believe that Christ has resurrected from the dead." So the words and the attitude of Thomas are coming to the forefront of the narrative. It is not good enough that the tomb is empty, that the grave clothes are folded neatly nearby, that multiple trustworthy people have witnessed this and have testified to the same. Thomas says, "I must see for myself in order to believe." And let's be honest. Is this not, at the heart of it, the human mentality? Unless I see it for myself, I will not believe. And so we see, number one, the pride of unbelief. But look with me, please, at verses 26 and 29 through 29, what I'm calling the invitation of the Savior. The invitation of the Savior in verses 26 through 29. The Bible says in verse 26, "And after 8 days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, 'Peace to you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Reach your finger here and look at my hands, and reach your hands here and put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing.'" So all that has taken place in verses 24 and 25 has taken place the day of the resurrection and the few days following. Now the narrative jumps forward 1 week to the following Sunday evening, when the Bible says that it was 8 days later, or after 8 days, verse 26. That's a common Jewish idiom, as Josephus explains for us, helps us understand. And the 8 day idiom means 1 week. And so we come again now to the following Sunday evening, where once again, verse 26, the disciples have gathered in the upper room, and this time Thomas is with them. Notice the deliberate parallel here in verse 26 compared to verse 19. It's the same disciples as the week before, but now including Thomas. It's the same upper room as before. The door was shut as before, meaning that this meeting was still secure and secretive, because the Jews, specifically the Sanhedrin, were out to get the disciples in the same way that the Sanhedrin had arrested the Lord Jesus and tortured him and crucified him. There was the same mentality towards Jesus' disciples. And the disciples, in spite of their love and loyalty for Jesus, they were not ready to be arrested, tortured, and crucified just yet. And so they went back to the upper room, a secure location, a secretive location, and they were meeting once again. However, we can only presume that a week later, the attitude of the disciples was decidedly different from the week before. The week before was fearful, and now we can only imagine that they are rejoicing that they know they have a resurrected Savior. Now, in verse 27, just as before, Jesus appeared in the midst of them, and he repeated the same phrase, "Peace to you." So what John is trying to do for us is to show us the parallels to the week before, but now there's something different. So the parallels, same room, same disciples, only one extra disciple, the notable one that was previously missing, same day of the week. Everything is the same, but now something majorly different is about to happen. And so Jesus, just as he had done the previous Sunday, now he does once again. He just appears in the midst of them. The Bible doesn't say anything about, you know, knocking on the door or identifying himself. I mean, the text would have us to believe, and it's probably what happened, that all of a sudden, poof, Jesus is just right there, boom, right in the midst of all of the disciples. They blink their eyes. One moment he's not there, the next moment he is. And so when Jesus appears, he says the same thing as he had said the week before, "Peace to you." Like I said, a common Jewish greeting, and also words that were very helpful and encouraging to these disciples. But now, the week before, Jesus had previously spoken to all of the disciples as a group, but this particular evening, he turns his laser-like attention upon Thomas, the eyes of the Savior piercing the soul of man. With no further preamble, Christ invites Thomas to look and feel and touch. In fact, there's no evidence that any of the disciples had told Jesus what Thomas had said before. Jesus just knows. Not only does Jesus know the disciples' previous conversation with Thomas, that the disciples had told Thomas, "We have seen the Lord," and Thomas responded in verse 25 the way we just discussed a moment ago, with some pompous arrogance, absolutely not. Not only does Jesus know what the disciples said to Thomas, but Jesus also understands Thomas's underlying attitude. Thomas has a heart of unbelief, and he is even proud of his unbelief. He is a proud skeptic. Once again, there is a common human theme here. People are proud of their own knowledge and skepticism. We believe ourselves to be a fortress of wisdom and a bulwark against folly. Furthermore, I must acknowledge that to some degree, skepticism is warranted. Only a fool believes everything he hears. And by the way, don't believe a lot or even much of what you hear or read on the internet. But there is a point at which skepticism is no longer warranted, but itself becomes foolishness. When the weight of evidence overwhelmingly points towards one conclusion. And in this case, the weight of evidence overwhelmingly pointed in the direction of a resurrected Savior. Thomas was now a fool to deny it. So we see in verse 27 that Jesus gives Thomas five direct commands. He says to Thomas, the first four, reach forth your fingers, look at my hands. Reach forth your hands and put them in my side. Now, these first four commands deal with the physical, empirical evidence for the resurrection. Jesus says in so many words, here is all the evidence that I've been crucified, that I died. You know it. Everybody knows it. Here's the proof that I was crucified. But here I am standing in front of you. What will you make of that, Thomas? You required some evidence. You said without that evidence, you'll never believe. And guess what, Thomas? Here's the evidence. Jesus is inviting Thomas to examine the evidence which Thomas himself demanded. But then again, Jesus makes one more statement at the end of verse 27. He says, do not be unbelieving, but believing. Now, this last statement about Jesus is particularly profound. Do not be unbelieving, but believing. The heart of the issue, as Jesus describes it, is that faith is a decision. It is not that people cannot believe in the resurrected Jesus, but rather that they refuse to believe because their own pride will not allow it. We understand that faith is a process to some degree, but the reality is that at the end of the day, we must make a decision as to who and what we will believe. And ultimately, the only warranted source of truth and faith is Jesus Christ himself, as revealed in God's word, the Bible. So finally, we see in verse 28 that Thomas has the response which he should have had days earlier. The Bible says in verse 28, and Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. This is both a pronouncement of the divinity and authority of Christ, but also it's a statement of the humility and submission of Thomas. Christ is superior to him, authoritative over him, and Thomas will now yield himself and his pride to Christ. In fact, we cannot help but note that the declaration of Thomas here resonates deeply with the purpose of the Gospel of John, as stated in the introduction to the book of John, John 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So we have the capstones to the book of John. In the beginning was the Word, who is God. And now Thomas says, my Lord and my God. In response, in verse 29, we hear the words of Jesus which transcend the upper room and spread their impact into every corner of the world through all time. Jesus Christ is speaking directly to you and me. Verse 29, Jesus said to him, Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and have yet believed. Thomas is both a good and bad example to everyone. Thankfully, he has believed in the end. But millions would come after Thomas who would not have the privilege to see like he did or touch like he did, but are still called to the same faith in the same Jesus. Jesus proclaims a special blessing for them. We'll consider that here in our final point. So number two, the invitation of the Savior. And that brings us very briefly to the end of our sermon. Number three, the blessedness of faith, which we read about in verses 30 and 31. The blessedness of faith. The Bible says in verse 30 and 31, and truly Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. So John explains in verse 30 that his purpose in writing this gospel was not to record every single amazing word and work which Jesus ever did. And John repeats that statement again in 21 verse 25. There are also many other things which Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. So John says twice at the end of his gospel, he's not trying to include every single thing that Jesus said and did. However, John specifically chose the words and deeds of Jesus which would most directly lead to faith. So in some ways, we are a little jealous of the disciples. We will never in this life have their blessed privilege to see and hear and feel what they experienced. And sometimes I'm sure that myself, just like you, experience a little bit of jealousy that we were not able to walk with Jesus on the dusty streets of Nazareth or Jerusalem. And in some ways, we're grateful that we didn't have to experience their sorrows. But at the same time, what a joy it would have been to walk with our Savior, to hear his voice and to see how he lived his life daily with our own eyes. But at the same time, Jesus says, we may be blessed and even doubly blessed with the same faith. We may be blessed and even doubly blessed with the same faith. In fact, verse 31, by merit of the testimony and example of these disciples, inspired and preserved for us in the Word of God, we can do what they did not. We can believe in Jesus on the basis of trustworthy witness alone. Such faith is warranted by the facts and testimony which we have received in the Word of God, and such faith leads to spiritual life through the name of Jesus. So we come to the end of our text today and we ask the question we always ask, what is the text trying to teach us? And when we reach the end of John chapter 20, because of the words of Jesus and John themselves, we know very clearly what the text is trying to teach us. There is a Savior. He is the divine God in the flesh. He did come to earth. He was born of a virgin. He did validate his ministry, both in his word, his preaching of the gospel, and his many miraculous deeds. He validated, and at the end of it, he died on the cross. He went to the tomb, and he triumphantly rose again the third day. By so doing, he unequivocally proved, as John says, that he is, and he is alone, the divine Son of God, sent to be the Savior of the world. And we have no choice on the basis of the witness which we have received, but to say the same words as Thomas. We can avoid the pompous, arrogant words of unbelief that Thomas said in verse 25. We don't have to say those words, but we must say the same words as he said, my Lord and my God, my King and my Savior. You alone are my Lord. You alone are my God. You alone are my Savior. I worship you. I obey you. I serve you. And in so doing, John says, we may have life, both in this life and in the life to come.